Today I will speak a little bit about codes and standards. I will just give you an introduction to the EN14972, NFPA 750, and some other projects. EN14972, it's the upcoming European water mist standard. As you can see, we basically have some documents we have to relate to here. For the sprinklers, you have the sprinkler Bible, I tend to call it, EN12845. For that, you also have some manufacturer's data sheets and so on. And for the component testing, you have the EN12259 series. For water mist, it's a bit different. Here you have the main standard that will come out. It's the 14972 part one. This part will basically contain how to install the system, like pumps and that sort of stuff. Then you have the fire test protocols coming in 2 to 17, the parts there. More parts will probably be added in the future. Then you have the manufacturer's unique information, which is the DIOM. This is due to that all water mist is performance based. So every manufacturer has their own systems. That means you have no comparison between the systems, because my system works differently to other manufacturers' systems for pressures, flows, spacings, and so on. All this has been found through full-scale fire testing. And then you have a system component protocols that also will come out later. To give you an overview over the PIN, as you can see, part one is design, installation, inspection, and maintenance. All these things are described in this one. That's the one coming out for voting now. Then you have part 2 to 17, which is all the protocols that are adopted by 14972. Some of the protocols, you have more to choose between, basically. If you look at the part 3, 4, and 7, all these are basically covering the same, like hotel rooms and so on. That means that you as a customer or installer have more systems to choose between. This was the compromise that came out, because everyone wants their standard to be in this standard or their protocol. So that was a compromise made in Cologne years ago. And it's also important to say that this standard has been worked on for 20 years plus. So. But here you can basically see that VDS, FM, LPCB, and SEN and ISO is represented here. Oops. Typical areas that will be covered through part 2 to 17. You have atriums, you have hotel rooms, you have server rooms, you have offices, car parks, etc., etc. Each of the protocols you can use for each application. And due to its application-based, you will use different systems all the way through the install. What happens if you don't have a standard covering these things? Well, then you can use the Annex A. This is basically how to develop a fire test procedure. This can be done as a cooperation between AHJs, test facilities, test laboratories, that is ISO 17025 accredited to do fire tests, owners, manufacturers, etc., etc. All these parts go together to develop this this new test protocol, if no protocol is available. And here you can see, well, if you evaluate the fire hazard, you will have a list of fire scenarios. You evaluate the compartment conditions, like ventilation conditions, structure conditions, volumes, areas. You determine the performance objective. Do you want extinguishment, suppression, control? Then you set up the fire test procedures. That's choice of fire tests, etc. Then you carry out the tests. That's the fun part. I have been involved in fire testing for many years. That's always good fun. Then you can verify if you have compliance with the protocol you have made. And of course, then you have the documentation and interpretation of the test results. And there you have the test report, the DIOM, et cetera, et cetera. The next step for this will basically be that it will be out for a formal vote, probably in the beginning of 2021. And if it ends up with a yes, then hopefully we will have an official European standard to go on with. How do you work with it? Well, of course, you start with a product. You go to the test lab, the ISO 17025 accredited test lab. You choose a fire test method found in the part 2 to 17. And you do some component testing as well, of course. Then you, from these tests, you make your DIOM. So when you do your fire testing and your component testing, everything you find here will be reflected in the DIOM, the design, install, operation and maintenance manual. So everything found through the testing and stated in the reports will be put into the DIOM. This DIOM will be evaluated by a third part, could be FM approvals, could be VDS, GNVGL, LPCB, et cetera, et cetera. Then you get a certificate or a witness letter and a final component test report. That way you are basically good to go. In a real project, the installer and consultant will look at what kind of application you have. Then he looks into the parts, what parts does he need to have. Then he can go and find the manufacturers of water mist systems who can provide these codes. And then these manufacturers and the installer has to give the AHJ all the test reports, the certificates, et cetera, et cetera. He can evaluate, does this fulfill my requirements? And well, then you can start a successful water mist project from there. NFPA 750, that's the American water mist standard. In NFPA, you also have the NFPA 13 that resembles the European sprinkler standard. And again, you can see with NFPA 750, they rely heavily on the DIOM manual. Again, all the things you have found through doing your full-scale fire testing. The fire test protocols, well, 750, they state that the system has to be listed and approved. And basically NFPA does not approve, inspect or certify any installations. They give guidelines on how to install a very good system. And if you follow that, you get to the more basic things like what products can you use? Not all the products has to be listed. You can take some drain valves, for example. They don't have to be listed, but they need to get approved by the AHJ that he agrees on these things. So basically the AHJ has the last word when you come to these systems. Then you have, what is the listing definition in NFPA 750? Well, I will not read it all, but you have to meet appropriate designated standards or have been tested and found suitable for a specified purpose. So this means that you can use a very broad variety of different manufacturers' products here. As long as your product, it can be high pressure, it can be low pressure, medium pressure, water mist, as long as it's listed, the AHJ will evaluate if it fulfills his requirements. So all these things has gone through successful fire and component testing and has to be recognized by test standards by a notifying body. The notifying body can be DNVGL, Lloyd's Register, LPCB, VDS, and so on, FM. What is important is here, you also take IMO standards into our protocols into the equation, so to speak. So you can basically use IMO standards if you go accordingly to NFPA 750. And other standards can be used as well. Then you have FM, the FM code 5560. Again,
since this presentation is made for you guys, I've also designed this slide, which gives a FM global view. So if we look at the fire testing component standards.
Sorry, I have something came in here. Fire test and component test standard code 5560. It's a general design installation and maintenance standard. It's a data sheet 4.2 that describes water mist systems. And then you have the code 5560. You will find a lot about the water mist systems in these data sheets, but also when you go through the testing accordingly to the protocol, FM 5560, you can find some of the stuff you need to design and install in there as well. Then you have special design requirements. For example, for the HC1 occupancies, there's a data sheet called 326, fire protection for non-storage occupancies. Data processing equipment rooms has data sheet 532, that's data centers and related occupancies. Then you have special design requirements as well. That could be transformers. Then that has a data sheet. So working with FM, everything is basically described how to do it through these data sheets. Everything is described, for example, for if you need to interlock with your ventilation to shut it down when you release the system, it's described in these data sheets. Then you have the water mist codes here. Again, put up a bit like the rest. FM code 5560, data sheet 4-2. The DIOM, still important to have, because otherwise you cannot install the system. It's different for each manufacturer of a system. And it has to be FM approved. And what you basically need to start installing this system is, of course, a certificate. You need the approval report from FM, and you need the DIOM from the manufacturer. These things the manufacturer needs to give to the installer, to the AHJ, and some of it also is relevant for the fitters out on the place.